Mijn naam is Henk, Henk ten Horen. And I have more than 40 years experience in organizations as a change agent, trying to change organizations from bureaucracy to client organizations, focused organizations, and to also to create more flexibility in organizations, to make organizations better perform. And I know a lot of it, but it's 40 years, it's a long time. I feel a little bit old, and I'm looking around you. You are all young people. You are the people of the future. You are ready for the future. Maybe you understand the future. But to be honest, about 30 years ago, it was already in the business science predicted what the principles are behind the blockchain. And what that we are moving to network organizations. And that we don't need management at all. But there are still companies with a lot of management. Well, I will explain that. In the last years, I'm not doing big projects anymore, change projects in organizations. My work is getting smaller and smaller, and I'm doing coaching, executive coaching of leaders. So my interventions are small, but the impact is growing, and I will continue that. But we are talking this afternoon about organizations, and of course, you know organizations. And I wonder who of you is an employer in organizations? Two? It's not much, not the half of the people. And who of you are independent ZZP, it's called in Holland, independent providers or consultants, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, and who of you are experts or technical experts? Okay, and did I forgot someone?
Employees.
Employees, yes. You are an employee?
Hmm.
Yes, and I think so there's a lot of variety here in this group, so we can use your experience. I think one of the main principles which managers don't understand is also in professional organizations, handling and managing independent professionals as employees. So that's, I think, one of the misunderstandings which going on. But let's start to find out what causes success in organizations. What makes an organization successful? What are the drivers of success and of good performance? Let's do a short inventory. What's your idea of that? You have maybe your experience by yourself, or you're reading in the papers.
Trust.
Okay. And who should trust who?
Ideally, everyone. Mm-hmm. Ideally, but most important, like employees, they are managers or their leaders.
Yeah.
And also the other way around.
Okay.
So
So top down and bottom up. Yes.
I would say, of course, people
system because you need to have your KPIs and your performance on a bar, but also having a trustful environment and structures that are either functional or flat or hierarchical, so that also plays out to the type of organization business.
Yes. Thank you. Very good. Very helpful. So I will come back to that. Does everybody know what a KPI is?
Key performance
indicator. Okay. Good. Thank you. And you?
Alignment of personal and shared purpose.
Alignment of personal and? Okay, alignment, very important, yes, thank you. And you?
Active listening.
Active listening, yeah.
Now we know the science. I think we can call it attention.
Attention?
The community of real leaders, not nominal leaders, is low cost for attention in community, you know?
That is
a... Everybody can listen to the leader.
Yes. Listen to the leader.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, and two more, and you?
Effective communication and the lack of it.
It's, I think it's also can be connected with alignment, and you need communication for alignment, so, and two more, yes?
Ambitious.
Sorry?
Ambitious.
The?
Ambitions.
Mission.
Ambition.
Ambition. Ambition. Okay. Yeah. And you, yes.
Something that relates to trust and active listening, feeling psychological safety.
Safety.
So meaning you can express yourself as you wish, whoever you are.
So one more, there are three more. What about you?
Well, from a very practical C-level perspective, for it to be a success driver, then there needs to be a proper bottom line.
Bottom line.
Profitability.
Profitability.
And it's great to come up with those things, but reality is profitability.
Okay, thank you, yes. And the last, you were at last.
Believing in the goal of the project.
The goal?
Believing.
Believing, okay. So, thank you. So, now there's much more, yeah, okay, last.
Okay, last one, and I think this word is actually encompassing everything, and it's balance.
Balance?
Balance.
Balance.
Profitability is about synergy. Problem.
It's very much about money. If I'm a C-level executive, it's very much about money. Sorry about this one.
No, thank you. It's all here. All the elements, they are all true. And there are different aspects of different levels of energy and different levels of the organization. I will explain that. And the next question is how to realize that, and if we know that is true, what should the leadership do, and what is the task and the duty and the capabilities and the competencies of the leaders to realize this? And one of the problems is that they have to do it all at the same time. So at this moment, I think most challenge for management and leadership is that they get crazy. It's too much. We know it everything, but how to do it by yourself? And one of the ideas is what we found out in business research in about 30 years ago, is that is the theory of David McClelland, looking at an organization, but also looking at an individual as an iceberg. And the characteristic of an iceberg is that there is a part above the water and a part below the water. This is visible and this is not visible. And we can use this image for defining success in organizations, but we can also use the same image for realizing what makes people successful and what makes people happy. And what we see above the surface is the what we call the tangible elements of an organization, and that is structure and procedures and planning and KPI and resources. And going deeper underwater, here is the organizational culture, but also the way the people in the organization cooperate with each other. And here are the organization values, but also an organization has also a soul that goes beyond purpose. This is the existence of an organization and the role of the organizations in the environment and in the world. And what is found out that most of our organizations are really able to handle the concrete elements of the organization, the tangible elements, but this part is not so visible and is not so tangible. It's not tangible, and therefore difficult to handle in a management way. And the message is what I found out, that for success in organizations, what is the difference between a very successful organization and a not so successful organization, and that is caused by the elements below the surface. And that makes it very difficult for management. For you can get trained to do this. Tell me how to do it. What do I have to learn? What skills do I need? What experience do I need? And this is an other part of the story. There's another dimension, and a lot of managers find it difficult. So, for instance, active listening, as you told, for how do you do that? Give me the 5 steps to active listening. But learning the 5 steps in a management way for active listening is preventing you, is hindering you to active listening. But because if you have 5 steps in your head, you are here. And it's better to get out of your head and go into your heart and understanding what another people, what an employee or another guy is saying, and looking for the connection. And that makes it successful. That's difficult to learn. It's not difficult to learn. It's very easy. But the way of learning is different, as we are used here. So that's about what is causing success in organization. And later on, I will also explain how it works for individuals in the same way. But to have an idea of... I do it here. No. To have an idea of what's creating balance in organizations, and there is, and that I was asked to explain to you how to create balance in organizations. And I think that should be a short presentation, for there is no balance in organizations, and organizations are not balanced. It's always an movement. If you're looking at a bird is in balance, but is not at always at the same moment in a stability state of flying. It goes this, and it's also in organizations. It's moving, but to create, to try to make a step into balance, I think it's good to understand what the mechanism is in an organization, how the organization is operating. And what we found out is that there are different types of organizations, different cultural types of organizations. And if we think of an organization, we often get directly the image of a pyramid with an organizational structure and CEO. And here, the grassroots. And a lot of the things you are saying about alignment and bottom-up are based on the image of a traditional organization. And it is defined by Mr. Mintzberg in the 70s as a machine. And in a machine organization, the structure is very important, structure and control. And the employee is part of the machine. And if some parts of the machine are not functioning, they are getting replaced. That's why people in an organization are called human resources. Resources, just as financial resources and other kind of resources. And what makes it very visual is the old movie picture of Charlie Chaplin. Maybe you know it, Modern Times. And that gives a very strong idea of how people are repressed in the system of a machine system. Then we have what started in the 60s and 70s, 80s, that the pyramid was turned down. That is called the process organization. And here, above the pyramid, is the client. And the boss is not important anymore in steering the process. For the steering the process is the client. All the energy here is focused on the client demands. And here, all the energy is focused on the demands of the boss. So the pyramid is turned down. And here, communication is a very critical element here. Here is instruction is the critical element, and here is alignment and communication, the critical element. The third one is the professional organization. Here are the professionals, are the product effect. the product of the organization are the experts in the organization. And then the fourth is the network, organization, and then fifth one is the holistic. And here is a lot of structure, and here the structure is totally disappeared. No structure anymore. And you can ask yourself if here are organizations, can we call this an organization? Do you have an idea? Do you know this theory? What do you think, and what are machine organizations at this moment who are very successful? Have you examples of it? What?
Revolut is a fintech company that is only focused on KPIs and.
Yeah. And what is their name? Revolut?
Revolut. It's a UK-based fintech.
Okay.
It's
I don't know.
The bank. Yeah.
The bank.
Yeah.
Very
hardcore.
Yeah.
Environment.
Okay. More examples?
Oracle?
Yeah? Is it here?
Yeah,
true? And is that the defect or is it the intention?
Well, after one of the co-owners died, it became more like that.
Yeah. That's interesting. So that there can be a difference for the origin.
Yes.
But the logic reason is behind the model, looking at the process and the clients and the needed culture and the actual state, what they are doing, there can be a difference. And for instance, I think the oil industry and the automotive industry and the in the Netherlands, the logistics, PostNL, And employees are part of the system. They have no influence what's going on. The system dictates what they have to do. And is it bad? What do you think? Is it a nice environment for you to work in? Thank you. Right answer.
I would counter that for many people, if we perceive ourselves as being viewed as a function more than a person, then that can have a dehumanizing element and take out the enjoyment of life.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why studies show that 86% of people are dissatisfied with their experience at work.
Yes. Yes. Okay. I will come back to that in a few seconds. Yes?
So there's a lot of individual variation that people attribute themselves as part of an ecosystem where they would like to work, whether it is performance, whether it is meaning, or whether it's just impulse. Right? And I feel that if you're part of the machine methodology per se, you might not have as much autonomy or your own vision to build something up. But then and it works for some people and doesn't, so it's very likely. But these the first level they also can get stuff done right based on the structures.
Okay, I will come back to that. Do you have examples of process oriented organizations? What's a typical process organization? Consultancy, marketing, and sometimes retail. If I asked the Jumbo organization, they find themselves here in this place. And that's how they define their organization. And a professional organization. Examples? Professional. In a professional organization, they are working professional experts. They are the product.
Welfare.
Maybe some, all some consultancy, I think.
A law firm.
Sorry?
Law firm.
Law, yeah. Yeah.
Science, the business.
Yes.
Universities.
Yes, universities. And I did a lot of work in universities, and there is a lot of struggle. And it's a misunderstanding internally who is managing the university. Because the managers and the board of a university thinks that the scientists and the professionals are employees. And they hate it. And that's, I was middle in the struggle that the university tried to implement management techniques as KPIs on the scientific population. It's a complete disaster. Network organizations. Examples?
Can you explain it?
Sorry, we?
Can you define it?
Yeah. And one of my colleagues, she is an management development officer at an organization working is financed by the ministry, and it's in the international water business. And what they are doing is educating engineers and creating a worldwide marketplace for these engineers, which can be hired by different countries or NGOs and so on. And that's a typical, there's no boss, there's no structure, but there is a training program and there is funding and everybody can join. And the holistic organization, yeah, sure. Yes. 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 And also combinations are, of course, possible. Why is this interesting? For you mentioned it already that there is not an ideal organization where there is balance, and if people looking for balance, they know where to go. Every element can be here and in balance. But it depends on the needs of employees and the needs of organizations, what the best fit is. But there are two tendencies. One tendency is the trend is from here to here. So even machine organizations have to organize in some levels as a network organization. For instance, a corporate environment needs a network of all the professionals worldwide in the technical areas and also in the HR and management development and leadership development. So that are a network-like systems where people know each other and can network together, as also peer coaching. So that's a combination. So my idea is that also machine organizations won't anymore exist only based on the hard structure and the procedures, so they need also elements of here. So there is a tendency going to this side. But it's interesting for a lot of people have the a desire for structure. And that makes it a real challenge to organize in these days, for if this is the main course, the main trend in organization land, it has an other impact and other demands on employees and managers. For here is a direction, a defined direction. Employees has to listen to the boss. But in these environments, to whom can employees listen? There's no boss anymore. What to do? So here, people are more dependent on themselves. And that's one. And the other one is that the performance of the organization, of the professional organization, the network construction, what did I like to explain? I don't know anymore. So there are not everybody likes to be fully responsible for what he is doing. There are a lot of people who like to be in a structured environment where they have protection. So what is here? Safety. The look for safety in a complex world is, everybody needs safety, but which is creating safety? And in the IND Business School in Lausanne started a project a few years ago with George Kohlreiser, and it's called Secure Base Management, that also in a chaotic, not structured organization, people can have the feeling that they are safe. So if our people are operating here, and I think that's all of you, you are the people of the new world operating in network organizations and finding your own way, that you have to trust on your inner compass. There is no outer compass, no direction by the organization defined. So you have to go inside and to look what your intuition is telling you. And that's true. And that's quite a challenge.
Thank you, Henk.
What about time?
I think we have still some minutes before we go on a break.
I have a short summary of 1 minute.
Yep.
Is that okay? So here's the answer of the three main questions, which was also in the program. The first question is, how does great leadership in fast-paced environments look like? What leaders do we need? And there is a study of Egon Zehnder. Egon Zehnder is the world's most famous recruiter for top positions in the management. And they're doing every 5 years a survey amongst the CEOs of the big international companies. And the last research survey was in September last year. And the statement came out is that CEOs recognize that today's unprecedented business complexity requires a significant change in leadership. And that change must begin by looking inward with new levels of self-reflection and personal development. Number one is to reflect on their own style. Number two is the need to continue with a self-transformation. And number three is that I realize that their weak point, their pitfall, is their own capability of bonding and creating relationships. So they are aware, and that's I think that's a good step, but not enough. And the second theme is, how do we foster healthy relationships between each other and in an organizational context? And that is what we have told and explained about secure-based leadership to connect. And that is Frédéric Laloux. And do you know his book, Reinventing Organizations? It's quite a cultural shock in the business environment. And that says, wisdom traditions from around the world speak to this, and this is a conspiracy of fear that involves employees to play it safe and to hide the selfhood behind a professional mask. From a deeper level, at heart, we are profoundly interconnected as a part of a whole. But it's a truth that we have forgotten. We are born into separation and raised to feel divided from our deeper nature, as well as from the people around us. Our deepest calling in life, these traditions tell us, is to reclaim wholeness within ourselves in our connection with the outside world. I have in my latest article, it was published in last year, end of last year. And it's translated in English. So if you like, please give me your name or for an email and I can send it to you. And the last one, it's really the last one. What are great ways to bring teams into performance and flow? And that's what we discussed about being aware of the outside alignment, but also the being aware of the context. So perfect team starts with an outside awareness, realize what the purpose of the team is in the environment, and then working together. So that I think that's the main element. So there are the answers of the three main questions of this afternoon, and we built the answers together. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Henk.
Yeah.
Any questions for Henk?
Yeah, when you draw the iceberg, you mentioned that organizations have souls. So what is this?
Have?
Soul.
Soul, yes.
So what is your definition of soul of an organization?
The definition of a soul, just as for us as humans, that is the connection. The soul is the bridge, the connection with the universe. And we can feel it, we can connect to that in meditation, but an organization has also a soul. And you can feel it if you enter an organization at the first desk and you see the buildings and the employees, you can feel if there is a living organization or it is a dead organization. Some organizations have lost the connection with their soul. But in change?
In the blockchain space.
Yeah.
Let's say a decentralized organization.
Yeah. But
the flat organization.
Yeah.
How would, keep in mind the soul and the philosophy of decentralization and also focus on people getting their KPIs or metrics
deliberate and optimized?
No, there are no KPIs, I think. There is the individual contribution to the wholeness. And sometimes it's valid and sometimes it's not. So everything is fluid and flexible. So the idea of a common goal and a common way and a common structure is there. And the invitation for a blockchain is to getting it loose and to trust on the individual capabilities of all participants, and also on the feeling, the intuition that they are, that it, that is the right track. So it's moving, and I think the first years is moving in this way, and the other way, and after some days it's moving that way, and that's okay. It's a completely new construct of thinking about organizing. Fascinating.
Something that occurred to me when you got down to holistic was I went, okay, we've actually got four operational capacities which are detailed in 1, 2, 3, 4. And holistic, in a sense, can be an embrace in which we can pull from whatever the strengths are that are represented inside of them. So, you know, in a very ugly diagrammatic form, we end up with something which is potentially like, you know, a little Star of David with each of the nodes on the network there contained in the circle of wholeness. Allowing us to go, okay,
That's true.
There's times for us to take leadership and work with structure. There's times for things to be dispersed.
Yes.
Each of them are potentialities.
And
holistic would be.
And if we all together are thinking in that way and are acting in that way, it exists.
It exists. And something else that came up though was recognizing that we all have different contexts within whatever a distributed power network may be. So that it might mean that certain people are holding context in relation to macro movement towards certain points, whilst other people are holding context towards movements within a specific domain, within a larger context, which in some ways can bring us back to elements of the original pyramidal structure, at least in sort of cognitive zones of conception.
And what we need to realize that is active listening.
Yes.
And with the serious intention to understand each other. And then the bonding is starting. And if the bonding is starting, there's a network.
You said before, sorry, I don't know your name is there, I'm not sure. It was effective communication. Yeah. And I think that this is really the heart and soul of what can make this possible.
Yes. So the circle is round, I think. Thank you.
Thank you.